psychotherapist, studied in political science and history, 5 years in San Francisco, 1 year with Sufism in Egypt, intensive encounter with Jesuitism, insight into the oneness of all religion. He recently published a book, 100 Years of Middle East Conflict, Honorable Peace. How can lasting peace be secured between the Muslim world and Israel? A very burning issue in nowadays, and our second scholar is going to talk about that. We are very, very excited to listen. Mr. Putin, please.
Thank you. Honorable Peace is the title of the book, and it's dealing about peace in the Middle East. And the entire subject of peace between Israel and Palestine got new actuality by President Trump's so-called deal of the century. I believe both sides will be better off with the interreligious vision of peace you will find in this new book of mine, of which I'm going to tell you now. To me, today is a day of gratitude. Gratitude to the Kingdom of Jordan because they introduced the interfaith harmony. And 3 years ago, I was given the opportunity here to tell a surprising story. And meanwhile, my story has become a book, as you can see. It all began with Martin Luther King's I Have a Dream. 3 years ago, I told the participants of this conference about my dream. Peace between Israel and Palestine. But how? You all know of the deadly enmity between the biblical brothers of Esau and Jacob, the grandchildren of Abraham. Esau was the firstborn, but Jacob stole his birthright. And Esau wanted to kill him, so Jacob had to flee. But in order to implement his stolen birthright, Jacob had to return and confront his brother, who was waiting for him with 400 mercenaries to be sure to kill him. All the rich gifts Jacob had brought with him would not suffice. In order to survive, Jacob had to come up with something unheard of, and he did. Walking towards Esau, he threw himself to the ground 7 times and asked for forgiveness. Esau could not believe what he saw, and he was moved. He bent down and lifted his brother up and hugged him. This gesture, I said, 3 years ago here, will again be needed today. Today, it will be up to the Prime Minister of Israel to reenact it. At the next General Assembly of the United Nations in New York, Israel's Prime Minister will have to ask the leaders of the Muslim world to come forward. And then he will ask them to forgive the Jews for all the trouble and pain that the founding of the State of Israel has caused them. But then, he will plead strongly with them to understand the plight of the Jews in 1947, right after the Holocaust, after 6 million Jews had been murdered. Utter desperation and the survival instinct left them with no choice but to grasp the only opportunity then open to them and set up a Jewish state in Palestine, a sanctuary where Jews would be protected from persecution. But even that gesture may not be enough. The Muslims, since their honor has been violated, will have to be addressed specifically. How could a truly honorable peace be attained when, in reality, the Jewish state was forced upon the Muslim world? My answer will, at the first glance, seem utterly unrealistic, because it states that honor could only be restored Muslims were one to allow the Jews to settle all over the biblical territory, and then to present the entire territory of today's state of Israel as a gift to the Jewish community. But how could anything as far-fetched as this become reality? The idea is not as unrealistic as it seems, but only a true Muslim authority could introduce it to public awareness. A true Muslim authority, such as the Imam of the Al-Azhar, could remind Muslims that practically all Muslim prophets, apart from the Prophet Muhammad, are biblical prophets. Muslims are thus deeply indebted to the biblical tradition. And now, after decades of not being able to overcome rooted enmity in both Palestinian and Israeli territory, there is an opportunity to obtain true peace by Muslims showing gratitude for what they have received. By presenting the entire territory of Israel to the people of the Bible, to the Jews, as a gift, thereby completely erasing all wrongdoings on both sides, restoring Muslim honor, and attaining true and lasting peace. But to arrive at that may call for a grand Muslim summit, something like the Second Vatican Council of the Catholic Church, a grand Muslim summit at Al-Azhar. And every Muslim knows that Al-Azhar was founded by the Shiites. So that summit will again bring together Sunni and Shiite to debate peace for Israel. And thus, the Muslim world will unite and create peace to the entire Middle East. But who am I to tell you such a dream? I am a Catholic theologian, as he has said. I also studied political science, and I lived in the United States for 5 years. There, I learned to see all religions as essentially one. And that led me to find a highly respected Muslim Sufi sheikh. In his Cairo community, I lived for a full year, nearly 40 years ago. There, I got to know Islam quite well, and the sheikh confirmed my insight. So, I became a psychotherapist, today dealing mainly with refugees from the Middle East. Then the shock of 9/11 revived my rich experiences with Islam. It made me realize that the forceful implantation of Israel in territory sacred to Muslims around Al-Quds, Jerusalem, was one of the main factors behind the murderous anti-Western ideology that had given rise to the 9/11 attack. When I concentrated on finding a way to approach the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, I realized that not only the Palestinians, but the Muslim Ummah, the entire religious community of Islam, are Israel's proper partners in peace negotiations. And I could understand that real peace must necessarily be a truly honorable